remember it when you do your exam, right? I will not provide the formula, so you need to spend your effort to try to remember it. But first understand it and then remember it, right? So we are interested finding the cost variance and efficiency variance for the production cost, right? So we are going to do this practice for the direct material, direct labor, variable overhead, and fixed overhead. And the focus is the first three items. And for the fixed overhead, I will just introduce the basic concept and pass it because it's not what I think is important. So just to review what we did for the direct material variance analysis, right? So we just utilized the formulas that we constructed, and then we kind of plug in the numbers for each one, right? So here, when we calculate the cost variance, we need the information of AQ, AC, SD. So for the AQ actual quantity, someone asked what is the actual quantity, right? It's actually the amount of direct material. So how many pounds of direct material we use to produce the actual level of production, right? So here the actual quantity is 300 production, all right? 300 units. You multiply that by the 26 pounds per unit. You get that? Okay. Right, so the product of this two is the actual quantity. And then actual cost is given here. Standard cost is given from the static budget, right? So now we have all the information, and we just need to plug in numbers and then generate the result. So here, when it comes to decide whether this variance is favorable or unfavorable, we just need to compare the items in the bracket, right? So here, in this case, the actual cost, which is $2.5, is greater than the standard cost, which is $2, right? So here, the actual cost is greater than the standard cost, and then we say this variance is unfavorable. And the amount of variance is 3,900. Okay? And then for the efficiency variance, we do the same thing, right? So we just need to go back to the information and take whatever we need in this formula. So here we need standard cost, the difference between the quantity, right? So for the standard quantity, it is just the expected pounds of direct material that we need to use to produce the actual level of production. So the standard quantity is just 300 by 25, right? And the other information is there already. So here, we just plug in the number. And from and when we reach this formula, right, we can compare the actual quantity and standard quantity. And here the actual quantity is greater than the standard quantity, so it means that we are less efficient in utilizing the materials to make the products, right? So we say that it's unfavorable. And the variance amount is $600. And from here, you should be able to observe the fact that if you add the cost variance and the efficiency variance, you are going to get the flexible budget variance. Because we say that what we do here is to just break down this flexible budget variance into the two elements, right? The two, the cost variance and the efficiency variance. So they should add up, right? They should, the sum of these two should be equal to the flexible budget variance. So that is for the direct material variance analysis. And we and then we did some discussion about why those unfavorable variances happen, right? So when it comes to the cost variance, the fact is that we pay more than we expected for the direct materials, right? So as managers and as accountants, we want to find out why, right? And then I list some reasons why we pay more than we expected. Right? So the reasons could be that, okay, maybe our suppliers just raised their price, or maybe the purchasing manager really just did a poor work in bidding, right? They could have obtained a better price, but they didn't do this. And then when it comes to the efficiency variance, unfavorable variance, we said that, oh, we actually used more materials than we expected. And then we think, what could happen, right? And then we said that, okay, maybe because of the waste, spoilage, theft of the materials, or maybe it's just because that the material has bad quality, right? Poor quality. So instead of using, like you need to use more materials to make the same unit of product, right? So those are the possible reasons. And as managers, we need to find out why this variance happened and then take corrective actions if needed, right? So that is the direct material variance analysis. And we can apply the same logic to do the variance analysis for direct labor, variable overhead. So let's look at the direct labor. And I will just invite some of you to do it on the whiteboard. So now we have this information, right? So if you don't have my slides, you should take a note. So now we have, so I said as before, right? From the static budget, we plan to produce 250 units of the product, and the actual production is 300. And now, from the static budget, the expected direct labor hour devoted to each product is 1 hour. And we expect to pay the workers $8 per hour. But the actual data tell us that to produce the 300 units, we in total use 300 to 55 hours. So here you notice that instead of giving the unit, the labor hour per unit, I gave a sum here, right? So this 355 labor hour is actually the actual quantity of the labor hours, right? So here we do not need to calculate the actual quantity by multiplying the 300 by something, because I already give you the total number. And this 8.2 is just the actual wage that we pay for our worker, right? So instead of paying them $8 per hour, we pay $8.2. So now, just following the same logic, I want you to break down the flexible budget variance for the direct material, for the direct labor, into the cost variance and the efficiency variance. And I will give you about 5 minutes, right, to do it, just to wake you up. Okay, guys, so did you solve it by yourself? Did you get the same answer as Michael did?
Yes.
Okay, so now Michael is on you. So you need to explain to everyone how you get the answer. Yeah,
yeah.
Just explain what is AQ, where is AQ from?
So the AQ, so that's
35.
And then the actual.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, guys, this is a skill that you need to have, right? So when you present to your classmates, you need to look at them and be loud, okay? So if you teach like this, nobody can hear you, right? My voice is loud, naturally. Okay.
So the actual quantity is 325. The actual cost was $8.20, and the standard cost was $8. So by the equation that we have for cost efficiency, it would be 325 times the difference between the actual cost and the standard cost, which is 20 cents, and then that would be $65. And it's unfavorable because you ended up spending more per unit than you budgeted for.
That's how we come with the solution, right? So that's a good job. Okay, thank you. So both Michael and Victor, they did it correctly, right? out. And the one with greater amount will dominate the net effect. Yeah. So as I mentioned, right, it's not enough to just reach the conclusion that okay, we have $65 unfavorable cost variance, or we have 200 unfavorable efficiency variance. It's not enough, right? We need to do some further investigation of why this unfavorable variance happened. So when it comes to the cost variance, right? The unfavorable situation is actually caused by the fact that we pay 20 cents more than we expected for the hourly wage, right? So we pay more for the direct labor, and then we want to find out why. So it could be that, okay, maybe the regulation says that the basic hourly wage just increased, right? So in that case, it's just a regulation thing, right? Nothing is wrong there. Or maybe we are hiring better workers, right? The workers with the skill that is very valuable, right? So we decide to pay them more because they have some skill that is not easy to find for from other workers, right? So that could be one reason. And then when it comes to the efficiency variance, like for the first part, you can think of other reasons, right? I just give you some examples. But if this happens right, in your organization, you need to find out the reason for your situation. And then for the efficiency variance, this unfavorable variance is caused by the fact that we use more direct labor hours than we expected, right? So some reasons for this could be, the person who's working on this production line, maybe they are poor trained, right? So they need to just spend more time on it because they are not that sophisticated or they are not that skilled. Or, as you mentioned, right, if the direct material has poor quality, maybe the workers just need to stay there longer to fix the issues caused by the quality problem of the direct material. Right, so there are so many reasons behind it. And as managers or accountants, we need to have a critical mind to find out the reasons, right? Rather than just looking at the data. The more interesting thing than the data itself is the stories behind it, right? So we should be aware of that. And then there's an interesting thing that we need to think about. So actually, this kind of variance always happens, right? Because in the real world, it's hard to say that we meet our expectation exactly, right? There are always exceptions, variances, no matter if $1, $10, or $200, or even thousands, right? So we always have exceptions. And the problem is we need to investigate each variance each and every time. So whenever we have the variance, we need to investigate every time when the variance comes up. So for example, we found out that, let's say, we have $1 unfavorable variance. We need to investigate that $1 unfavorable? No, right? Because the $1 seems to us it's very tiny variance, right? So that's correct, because we do not have that energy, right, or resources to investigate each and every variance that comes up, right? So we need to have some prioritization. And we do this by setting an acceptable range. For example, we can say that we only investigate the variance that exceeds $100, right? And then this $100 is your acceptable variation. This means that if you have any variation that is less than or equal to $100, then you think it's not material, right? You think that it's fine, right? Because it's just some normal friction in the business procedures. However, majority, we deal with exceptions, right? We only investigate the variances that we think is serious enough, right? That is material enough. So that's just a side note. I'm going to skip this. So now that we discussed how to do the variance analysis for direct material and direct labor, right? Now I'm moving on to the variable manufacturing overhead. So for the manufacturing overhead, we know that like in the second chapter, I forgot, but in the very first chapter, we discussed the predetermined overhead rate, right? The predetermined overhead rate is calculated by taking the ratio of the estimated overhead cost and the estimated allocation cost, right? Basically, that says what we expect the overhead cost to be for each, based on each allocation base, right, per unit. So by that definition, right, what cost do you think predetermined overhead rate belongs to? Is that actual cost or standard cost? Right, by the definition of predetermined overhead rate, do you think that it should be, it should be the standard cost, right? So we think that when we do the variance analysis for overhead, right, where to find the standard cost, where to find SC. The SC is just the predetermined overhead rate, okay? So in this, in the information I listed here, right, we have the predetermined overhead rate for the variable overhead, it's $6 per machine hour. And then the standard for machine hour is 4 machine hours per unit of production. So this one is actually the our expected time spent to produce each, expected machine hour to produce each product. And then we have the actual overhead cost and the actual usage. The actual usage is in terms of the machine hours. So let's see how we can do the variance analysis for the variable overhead. We are going to see. Okay. So for the cost variance, we already know that the formula is like this, right? We use actual quantity multiplied by the difference between the actual unit cost and the standard unit cost. However, right, when we approach to this problem, let's first find what is AQ. So in this problem, the AQ is actually implicitly given. AQ is explicitly given. It's here, right? Actual usage of the machine hour is 1,300. Okay. And what is AC? So the AC is missing, right? Because the AC actually means the actual unit cost of the variable overhead, and it's not shown here. So this one, right, the actual overhead, the actual variable overhead cost is already the product of AQ and AC. Okay, can you see the linkage here? Right. So if I want to find AC, actually we need to divide the actual total variable overhead by the actual usage, right? Which we do not need to, because if we go to this formula, right, we can just use that product directly. Some of you might get confused. Let's just see this way. So if we expand that formula, right, the cost variance is AQ by difference between AC and SC, right? So if we expand it, it's actually AQ by AC minus AQ by SC, right? And convenient for us to find the cost variance in this problem. Because as I mentioned, the product of AQ and AC is directly given, right? So for this part, for AQ by AC, we already know that it's 7,540. Okay? And then AQ is given there, it's 1,800 machine hours. And SD is the predetermined overhead rate, which is 60. So in this way, we can utilize all the existing information, right, to calculate the cost there. So it depends on how we present the information, right? So sometimes we are not going to be separately what is AC, what is AQ, right? Sometimes the information is already aggregated, right? So you need to understand what that information means, right? So in this case, the actual overhead, variable overhead, is by itself a product of AQ and AC, right? So we just use it directly. So using that method, we can calculate that the variance is, in terms of dollar amount, is 260. And here, it's favorable, right? The reason is because if we, okay, so we look at this part, right? So the actual variable cost is 7,540, which is smaller than the expectation, right? So this is favorable. And then for the efficiency variance, the information is already there, and you can do it in the same way that we did before, right? And then you can come up with the variance, which is 600 unfavorable. So now we have the cost variance and efficiency variance. By adding them up, right, we can get the flexible budget variance. So in this case, we have a favorable cost variance and unfavorable efficiency variance. But the dollar amount of the efficiency variance is greater than the dollar amount of cost variance. So if you add them up, will the flexible budget variance be favorable or unfavorable? Unfavorable, right? Because here, the impact of the unfavorable dominates that of the favorable, right? And so what should be the amount if we add them up? What is that? 340. Yeah, it's because it's like adding a number with the opposite side, right? Because part of them will offset by themselves. So the net effect is actually the difference between the two, right? And the sign is the one which dominates, right? Whose impact dominates. So this is for the variable overhead. Variance analysis. And we are going to discuss the reasons behind the variances as before, right? So for the cost variance, it shows that we actually spend more on the spend less on the overhead than we expected, which is a favorable situation. And the reasons could be that we might just use less. For example, office utilities, right? But when it comes to the efficiency variance, we use more machine hours than we expected. And the reason could be that, maybe the machine is getting old, that's why it's less efficient, right? So we can find the reasons behind it. Okay, so just to summarize, right? We will do the various analysis for direct material, direct labor, and variable overhead. We just need to utilize this formula, right? So the cost variance is the AQ multiplied by the difference between AC and D, and efficiency variance is like this. So that's what you need to grasp, actually. And for the, when we do the variance analysis for fixed overhead, things are very different, and I will just scratch the preface and then leave, because I don't want to confuse you with what we need preface. So when we do the variance analysis for the fixed overhead, we just define that the cost variance is the difference between actual fixed overhead and the budget fixed overhead. And the volume, and instead of calling efficiency variance, we call it volume variance. And that volume variance is defined as the difference between budget fixed overhead and the allocated fixed overhead. So things are a little bit different when it comes to the fixed overhead. So you just need to remember the fact that when it comes to the fixed overhead, we do say differently, right? And I will not include this in the homework, nor in the exam. So you just need to know that, okay, what we learned before only applies to the variable production cost, right? Direct material, direct labor, and variable overhead. And then just remember that fixed overhead is a little bit different. And then that's it for this chapter. So this chapter, as I mentioned, right, so you just need to see the big picture that I gave, that I showed in one of the slides. Where is it? Yeah, this one, right? So in this chapter, right, we basically introduce several variances, right? We first said static budget variance is the difference between the actual performance and static budget performance. And we break it down into the flexible budget variance and the sales volume variance, right? And then we further break down the flexible budget variance into the cost variance and efficiency variance. So we have 5 variances that you need to understand and remember, right? Be careful of those terms, and I will not give you the formulas in the exam, right? So you really need to understand them and know how to apply them. So this is kind of like a summary for the whole chapter, right? What do we need, and what are the relationships between different variances, right? So this is for chapter 23, right? One of the most challenging chapters for this course.
Okay. Yeah. I have a question. In the variable MOH, would the actual MOH always be the product of the
two? Most of the time. Most of the time. Yeah.
Okay. So it shouldn't be like that.
Yeah. Yes. 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 Okay. Yes. Yes. So I think that is valuable for us to wrap up this chapter by doing this demonstration problem, okay? Okay, so now this is the demonstration problem. And if you don't have my slides, you can take a note of all the information. So, okay, I will read and interpret the information here. So this company has the following budgeting information, okay? So the first one, 3 direct labor hours per unit. This is the budgeting information, okay? You can see it as the standard. So they expect that they will spend 3 direct labor hours for 1 unit of production. And then the standard wage that they pay to the worker, they expect to pay to the worker is $17 per hour. And the following, so from November, right, they collected the actual data. So the actual total direct labor hour is 189. And they actually completed 84 units of production, and all of them were sold. And the workers were actually paid by $17.8 per hour.
May I have the slide number?
The
PowerPoint slide.
What do you mean?
The number of the slide.
I think it's different from the handouts, because this one, I have more slides on my presentation slide. But it's somewhere between, it should be after the direct labor variance. Yeah. So we know all the elements here, right? And the most important thing is actually how to find the corresponding information correctly. So Carolina just used the 84 units, which is not the what AQ means, right? The actual quantity is actually the, when it comes to direct material, it's the actual pound of direct material we use to produce the actual level of production, right? And when it comes to direct labor cost, the actual quantity is the actual amount of direct labor hours we devote to produce that actual level of units, right? And so here is the actual labor, right? We need to find out the actual direct labor hours that we use to produce the 84 units. And this AQ has already been given directly by the first line after in November, right? So they said actually worked 189 direct labor hours, right? So this is AQ. And then the AC and SD is very easy to locate, right? AC is actually the actual direct labor hour, hourly wage we pay, which is 17.8. And then the SD is just what we expect to pay, which is 17, right? And the dollar amount is what we calculated here. And when it comes to the judgment of favorable or unfavorable, we look at the difference between AC and SD, right? And here we pay, we actually pay 80 cents more than we expected, right? So here, this is unfavorable, right? So this is correct. The next question, what is the efficiency variance? So what we calculate here is the cost variance, right? And now we need to find out the efficiency variance. So the majority got it correct, right? And some also did it correct with some of the adjustments. So the formula is here, right? The standard cost by the difference between standard quantity and the standard cost is just the expected hourly wage we pay, 17, right? And the difficult part is to calculate the standard quantity, right? The standard quantity, when it comes to direct labor, is the expected amount of direct labor hours that we need to use to produce the actual level of production, right? So here, the actual level of production is 84 units. But by expectation, we need to spend 3 hours per unit. Right? So we multiply the actual level of production by 3 hours per unit. And this is 292, right? Which is the standard quantity for the direct labor hours. And the actual quantity of direct labor hour is always given as 189, which we already discussed, right? And then, so Gio was asking whether it's important to follow the sequence that I gave in the original formula. But actually, it doesn't matter because it's fine whether you put AQ in the front or C in the front. The most important thing is that we just match each number, right? So in this case, we see, oh, the standard quantity is greater than the actual quantity. And then it means that we are efficient, right? So we have favorable. And if you write AQ minus SQ, right? Then when you write the actual number, you just need to make sure that, well, the AQ is 189 minus 92, right? And you see, oh, the AQ is less than the SQ, so it's there, right? So it doesn't matter which one comes first. The most important thing is that you know which one is which, and then compare. And the end result is always the absolute value and the size, right? Favorable or unfavorable. So that's the second question. So the third question is, now we know the cost variance and the efficiency variance what is the flexible budget then? Right? So that's the third question. Oh, there's no third question. For you. But can you please calculate now what is the flexible budget? So we have, what's that?
something, right?
Is evaluated by the sales revenue that you bring in, right? For the sales manager, you care about how well you generate the sales revenue, right? So in this case, we call the sales department revenue center, okay? So here we have this concept of revenue center. So in the revenue center, the managers, they only focus on the revenue, right? So for example, for the sales manager, their major concern is to bring in more sales revenue, right? They don't consider the costs or whatever, so they just want to sell more. And for the production manager, right, they are on the production line. So they care about, for example, the direct material cost, direct labor cost, overhead cost. And usually they don't consider, they don't care about the sales side, right? Because what they do is just to produce the product. And they deal with all the production costs. So we call the production department cost centers because they only care about, for example, how to reduce the cost or how to better manage the cost, right? So that's revenue center and cost center. But if we look at the talent department, right? So let's say I'm the manager of the So if we look at the standard tablet department, right? If I'm the manager of that standard tablet department, I kind of manage both the production line and the sales line, right? So I need to consider both the revenue generated from the sales department and the cost incurred in the production line, right? So I need to care about both the revenue and cost, which means that I need to care about the profit, right? So for the standard tablet department, right, which manages both production line and the sales department, they are considered as the profit center because these managers need to consider both the revenue and cost, which produces the profit, right? So we call them profit centers. But for this kind of department managers, like for example, I am the manager of the standard tablet. Usually I don't have the right to decide some upper level decisions. For example, whether to purchase another machine for the production or increase the production line. Those are the decisions usually made by upper level managers. And so let's say I am the tablet computer division manager, right? And I feel that, okay, maybe the standard tablet and premium tablet is not enough. They are not enough for the consumers. And we need to add another kind of tablet, right? So for this kind of decision, it's really about strategic, like your strategies on how to expand the market or how to improve the market share, right? So for this kind of decision, it requires the decision made on capital expenditures, which relates to this kind of investment activity. So we call that this kind of manager, or this kind of division, investment center. So when you consider whether a department is investment center or not, it's just to look at whether this division or this manager have the power to decide, for example, whether to increase the another production line, whether to purchase a factory, whether to rent a like a store, something like that. Right? If not, then most of the time they are I'm not setting up the clicker here, so we are going to come back on Wednesday to